Good morning, and welcome to this service of worship. I am the Reverend William D. Ingraham, and I have the distinct honor and joy of serving First Church Congregational of Methuen, Massachusetts, United Church of Christ as senior pastor. On behalf of all of our members and all of our friends, welcome to this service. It is the fourth Sunday of Advent, and it is also the 41st Sunday of quarantine. And we are grateful for all the people who are participating in our service each and every week. Thank you for joining us, and thank you for holding us in your prayers. Thank you for your generosity of spirit and also the gift you have been giving our church to support our work. We really appreciate it. So if you have a moment during this service to check in on Facebook, if you're watching us on Facebook Live, that will be fabulous. You can just post a little note welcoming people, letting us know that you're there. Also, make sure you do the thumbs up for like or the little heart for love or whichever one of those emojis is most appropriate for your experience of worship in that moment. All those things both help us be community together in all of our different places, which is a challenge, but also it helps boost our service in the Facebook algorithm so that more people have our service show up. And so it's a way of reaching even more folks. And if you found our service that way, welcome. We're so glad you're here. So Christmas is coming this week. On Thursday night at 7 p.m. will be the Christmas Eve service. We will again be lighting the Advent candles and that night the Christ candle. At the end of the service, we will have Silent Night. And with Silent Night, we hope you'll have candles to light from the Christ candle in your nativity creche Advent wreath, so that you can join us as we sing Silent Night. Maybe you'll even turn off the lights in your house. Who knows? But know that we want you to be able to join us and share the joy of that evening. So this week, the chapel school will be open on Monday and Tuesday, and then they go on their Christmas early winter break, and they won't be back until January. We hold all of our students in our prayers and give thanksgiving to God for our teachers and also for our administrator Roberta, who both manages the office for the preschool and for the church, and also our director, Cindy, who has served us faithfully for more than 25 years on the chapel school staff. After Tuesday, when Roberta leaves at the end of her workday, there will not be regular church office hours again until the beginning of January. But folks aren't dropping by for office hours anyway because we have the preschool. Just know that you need to email Roberta if you have anything that she needs to have so that she has it in time to make the bulletin. She'll still be doing all those things. She just won't be in on her regular schedule because it's the between time. So you saw in the email that the Festival of Trees has finished their display last night. I hope you got to go and see it. I did. It was beautiful. I went last night with all the snow. It was remarkable, truly, just gorgeous. In fact, all around Methuen, I've noticed a whole lot more Christmas lights out than I've seen in past years. And it's been a real joy and very uplifting for my spirits. Well, they need a place. They need homes for a whole lot of cut trees that they use for their display. So if you need a cut tree, feel free to be in touch with me or with the church office, and we will make sure that you can swing by Gray Court and pick up a tree, because as many as they can, they want to get those to homes for people who would like to have one. That's pretty much what I have for announcements today. I do want to share, I don't know if you can see it, but my tie today. This purple tie, one of my favorite ties, it belonged to one of the saints of our church, Larry Remick. He was sitting, he sat right there, but he wasn't sitting there with Tom Savastano as he normally did when I saw the tie. He was sitting outside my office, and I said, "Larry, that's a great tie. I really like it." He said, "Why, thank you." Then on Tuesday that week, I came into the office, and this tie was on my desk. He had brought it in on Monday after I'd gone home, and the next Sunday, I thanked him for the tie, and he said, "What tie?" Which I don't know to this day. Did he not remember, or was he just denying being modest? But I have worn this tie every Advent and every Lent since he gave it to me. I also wore it when we celebrated his life at his funeral. We continue to hold Larry and all of the saints of our church in our hearts as we go through this season of Advent, of anticipating the coming love and compassion of God that those saints already know and live in person in God's own heaven. Food pantry continues. I didn't mention the food pantry. We've still been serving large numbers. This week on Tuesday night, we'll have the food pantry as normal. And between Christmas and New Year's, when Neighbors in Need normally takes a week off, we are going to keep our food pantry open. We're very concerned about hunger in the Merrimack Valley and Northern Essex County. And so we've been serving almost 400 families every week. And so we're handling that food pantry ourselves. Thank you to everybody who's bringing food. And also we've had an influx of cash donations lately. And that's really important. It helps us keep that food pantry going. We supplement what Neighbors in Need is able to provide for that pantry. Those are the announcements that I have today. Let's move on to joys and concerns. You find some listed in the bulletin, and we're still inviting people to email Roberta to get joys and concerns listed in the bulletin, and we hold all those people in our prayers. Today in the joys and concerns, I want to just give my own urging, a plea really, to ask you to be most careful during this holiday season. The numbers in the pandemic are continuing to go up. I started to say spike. I don't think we're anywhere near the spike yet, the peak of this wave. And so please be careful. Wear a mask. If you're at all able, limit your gatherings, your direct contact with folks. It's really hard. I know. I did Thanksgiving alone, and I'm going to do Christmas alone, and I just keep telling myself, the flaming extrovert that I am, I keep telling myself, I can do this. I can do this. Vaccine is coming. It's already being rolled out. We're going to make it. And so please do be extra, extra careful. And by putting your own health first, you're actually putting the health and safety of our whole community first. And that's a worthy effort for all of us. So we also just are aware of the struggles the holidays can be, especially for those who recently have lost a loved one. But even those of us whose grief is from deaths long distant, the holidays remind us of absence. And in a year of pandemic, that's even harder. So we pray for everyone who is grieving and ask God's blessing of comfort for all of us in our stage of grief. We also pray for people living with addictions, grateful for sobriety. And as you're going through the holidays, if you are a person who's addicted, I encourage you to talk to your sponsor, get to a program meeting, do what you need to help maintain your sobriety during this time. Work the program. It's worth the effort. We also pray for people. So we prayed for all people who live with addictions. We pray for people who are grieving. We also pray for people with mental illness, whatever expression it may take. And we pray for people with physical illness, people who are undergoing treatments or therapies, people who are living with long-term disabilities or medical or physical impairments. And we give thanks to God for doctors, nurses, physician's assistants, all the people who help out in the healthcare profession. That's what I have listed for today. I know that you have other joys and concerns, and we will let you invite you to hold them in your heart, especially when we have our prayer time together. I did actually think of one more thing. I want to just thank you for, I know I said something briefly about this earlier, but thank you for your love and support of this church, our life, our faith, our ministry. What a difference you're making with your generosity of gifts, people that are keeping their tithes going and strong, people that are sending in offerings, people who are caring for the financial welfare of this church, but even more, the different ways you're being loving and supportive of each other and even of me. I am so grateful, and I praise God for the love of this church and the faith that has sustained us for three centuries and is helping us not only to make it through this pandemic, but to thrive through this pandemic as we continue to serve God. Okay, that's enough from me. Let's now move to the lighting of the Advent candle.
Good morning. My name is Sue Riedel. I'm the diaconate chair here at First Church. Please join me in the lighting of the Advent wreath. This is the fourth Sunday of Advent. Today we will light all four candles. The first candle was the candle of peace, reminding us of God's gift of peace, not just for us, but for all of the world. The second candle was the candle of hope, reminding us that we have hope in God, no matter what may come our way. The third candle, the pink candle, the candle of joy, reminding us that God's gifts us with joy we can depend on. The fourth candle of Advent is the candle of love. It reminds us of God's boundless love, love for you and love for me, love for our church family, and love for every church and all who gather faithfully everywhere, love for all the world forever and ever. Long ago, God came to us in a little child in Bethlehem's manger. Mary's faith and courage welcoming the Christ child into the world, and she and Joseph held him and sheltered him in love so he would be safe and would grow up to make God's love known. Let us light the candles together. We begin by lighting the first week's candle, the candle of peace. Next, we light the candle of hope. And the pink candle, the candle of joy. Finally, we light the fourth candle, the candle of love. Please pray with me. God of heaven and earth, we thank you for your boundless love for us and for everyone everywhere. Open our hearts to your gift of love made known to us in the baby Jesus. Help us to share that love as your gift for all the world. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
Come, desire of nations, bind all people in one heart and mind. Make envy, strife, and quarrels cease. Fill the whole world with heaven's peace. Rejoice, rejoice. Emmanuel shall come to you, O Israel.
Please join me in the morning prayer. We gather in Christ's name, offering our prayers and songs of praise. Week after week, you remember your gifts of peace, hope, joy, and love. Your blessings are light for the darkness, and we are grateful beyond measure. Trusting in the bounty of your care and compassion, help us to live faithful and loving lives. Give us a generosity of heart that shares the good news of Christ's coming in all we say and do. We ask this in the name of Bethlehem's babe. Amen.
Thank you, Sue and Joe. It has been really nice to have some special music in our services. I'm grateful. And singers in our church, beware. We're hoping to recruit you to continue these lines of solos and duets as we move forward. It's time. We're ready to have music again. So, time for the children's time. And so, I'll invite kids to join me in our virtual service, gathering around. And as I sometimes say, it's for children, youth, and everyone who's young at heart, for all of us, a time for the special message. So today is the fourth Sunday of Advent. That means Christmas is almost here. In fact, some churches celebrate this as Christmas Sunday, and so there are times that a church skips the end of Advent. We're not doing that this year. We're following the themes of Advent all the way through the theme of preparing, the theme of waiting, the theme of looking to God for peace and hope and joy and love? Is that kind of funny, odd reality of our faith that we both know that Jesus was already born? On one side, we know he was already born a long time ago in a manger in Bethlehem, lived his whole life, grew up, was a teenager, was a young adult, did his ministry, walked on water, fed hungry people, raised Lazarus from the dead, did cast out demons, all sorts of amazing things we don't even think about nowadays, and then was betrayed, arrested, crucified, died, buried, rose again. All that's quite literally ancient history, 2,000 years ago. But every year we get ready again for the birth of Jesus because we believe in our faith that we always have to be preparing for Christ at his coming. We always have to get ready for Jesus to be born to us. And there's something really special about thinking of Jesus, God's Son, God incarnate, meaning God in human form, Emmanuel, the term we use. It's in the O Come, O Come, Emmanuel. I've been singing at the start of each service. Emmanuel means God with us. This Holy One who came to teach us about love and compassion was born a little bitty, helpless baby. Oh my goodness. And so we prepare to receive into our lives this little bitty, helpless baby potential of great things who comes to turn the world on its ear and make everything different. And so for 4 weeks before Christmas, we prepare ourselves. So have you been getting ready? Are you getting ready for Christmas? Okay, maybe not the baby Jesus, but getting ready for Christmas Day. I'm kind of excited about Christmas Day, even though it's just going to be me this year. I sometimes go to a friend's house. I sometimes rush off to be with family somewhere. Last year, I went down and met friends in New York City, and we stayed in a hotel and had nice meals and walked around and got exhausted all the time. This year, it's just going to be me and my house. Maybe it'll just be you and your family. Maybe small groups are getting together. But still, there's a lot of getting ready to be done. There's cookies to be baked. There's cleaning up to be done. There's gifts to be wrapped and prepared and put under the trees. There's all these hopes. We got good news this week from Dr. Anthony Fauci that he has inoculated Santa Claus, so that's good. He's had the vaccine. He's safe to come out and deliver presents, so we're all good for Christmas. But still, it's not here yet, so we're getting ready and we're preparing. So what do you have left? And how are you going to get ready for Christmas? And maybe more importantly, how are you going to get ready to welcome God's love and compassion into your life? We often in faith circles talk about into our hearts. We accept God's love into our hearts, Jesus' love into our hearts, the gift of God's forgiveness into our hearts. I know there's not like a little compartment here that we can open up and put it in like a present, but that means into the core of who we are. Our most deeply frightened places, the places where we might feel guilty or sad, our happy places, our hopeful places, our secret places, all these depths of who we really are, we prepare to welcome the gift of God's love to our deepest selves so that we can celebrate God's love that holds us always and forever. Christmas is coming. Just 4 days away now. We're almost there. Are you ready? Please pray with me. Dear God, we thank you for the gift of Jesus, and we're doing our best to get ready. And the pastor forgot. It's a repeat after me prayer. Dear God, we're thankful for Jesus as a gift to us. Help us to be ready. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Sometimes I get excited. I was so excited, I just wanted to pray a big old prayer. But now's my chance, because now's the time for our pastoral prayer. I invite you, please, to join me in the spirit of prayer as we offer our very lives and our hearts and our hopes and our dreams and our hurts and our needs to the God of love who holds us always. Please pray with me. Most gracious and loving God, you bless us in ways we cannot even comprehend. As much as we know about your blessings, as great as they are still far more remarkable than we can even know. And you continue to bless us day after day. Give us grateful hearts, and help us to live with an assurance of boundless heavenly love and endless compassion that hold us dear to you and near to your heart, and empower us for faithful living all the days of our lives. We come into this time and offer you our prayers, grateful that you hear our prayers and grant us peace and healing and hope and assurance. We lift up all of our concerns to you, asking your blessing, asking for healing for those who need it, asking for hope for those who need it, asking for a sense of guidance for those who need it, asking for your blessings to fill and sustain all of us and all that we are and all that we do. Give us courage to ask you for help. Give us strength to hold on while your healing power is at work within us and in the world around us. And give us a sense of courage to live through these days, these pandemic days, with a strong sense of hope that comes from you and that reminds us, sure as the rising sun in the morning, your love will greet us each and every day and empower us to live to the fullness of the joy you have prepared for us. We pray for this church, grateful for the ways we strive to serve you in this place, the love and support we offer to each other, and the ways we seek to offer your love and support in the world around us. Bless our church and empower us to serve you faithfully today and every day, as we have sought to do for three centuries now. We pray for people of faith everywhere, in every religious setting, known and unknown, and all those who seek to make love a part of who they are and how they live in the world. Bless us in our endeavors that we might know love and share love too. We hold special prayers for everyone working to fight the COVID-19 pandemic, medical people, chemists and scientists creating vaccines, people helping to deploy the vaccines around the world and across our nation and even here in our town. We pray also for all those living with the coronavirus and ask you to help us to do the best we can to stay healthy and safe as we live for a treatment and a cure. We have other prayers we offer today. We hold them in our hearts and offer you now our silent prayers in Christ's name. We pray these things in the name of Jesus as we offer now the prayer he has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We come now to the time for the offering, and I know most of us who are members of the church, our pledge comes out of our accounts automatically on the 15th, and so it's already happened for December. And the rest of us at the church so faithfully mail in checks that we've received most of those offerings already, yet others right now might be using the link on the bottom of the page to make an offering. No matter how you give or what you give, my prayer is that you offer your gifts to God's service, that in this church and in the world around us, God's will might be done, that our gifts might help accomplish love and compassion in ways that make a real difference. We take a moment now to receive the offering as we listen to the offertory.
The scripture reading this morning comes from the book of Luke, chapter 1, verse 26 through 38. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of the greeting this may be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor, David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child will be born holy. He will be called the Son of God. And now, your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son, and this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. May the living word of God speak to us through these ancient words of scripture.
Thank you, Sue. Light for the darkness has been the start of every sermon title these four Sundays of Advent. And this week, the word that modifies it is doing. Light for the darkness, doing. So today we have the passage about Mary, the passage where the angel Gabriel comes to Mary. Gabriel, probably the best known angel in the Bible, named three places. The angel Gabriel comes to Joseph in Matthew. The angel Gabriel comes to Mary in Luke. The angel Gabriel comes to Daniel in the Hebrew Bible. I was looking while Sue read back to see if the angel that announces Elizabeth's pregnancy was named, but the angel is not. One of the things I had thought about saying today was, what would you do if you saw an angel? That was something that was on my mind a lot this week. There was a Christmas pageant I went and saw I was in the Shenandoah Valley for just 9 months. It was between my church in Albuquerque and my call to this church here. I was still searching, and so I had taken a short-term designated pastorate. And while I was there, there was a congregation, and I can't remember if they were Jehovah's Witness. I think they were Jehovah's Witness. They might have been Seventh-day Adventist. Anyway, they worshiped on Saturday. There was a congregation in a nearby town that put on this huge Christmas pageant, but it wasn't just a Christmas pageant like we do in our church with all the different characters that come up and do it. No. It was set on acres of property. They had their huge church building, they had a school, they had a farmyard next door, and so they worked out this Christmas pageant. It started with us sitting in the sanctuary waiting our turn. They would call on groups by number and take, and you would meet your guides, and then they would take you on the road, and you went through the whole story of the birth narrative. And so you came, anyway, went through the village. There were all sorts of things going on. The thing I remember the most was after you'd been through the village and through all this Warren and all these different places where the different people spoke to you, you went outside and started down a road. It was a long road. And you walked in this little group of about 10, 12 people down the road, led by the people who had been our guides from the start. And then we got to the place where there were shepherds. And so we met some shepherds standing there with sheep. And it was dark because it was at night. And then when it came in the time and the story that the angels came to speak to the shepherds, all at once this light lit up on the top of the hill, and there was this loud crashing rock and roll music. And there were backlit, all these angels and this chorus of angels on top of the hill. And I remember as we were walking along, I was there with a family from my church. And there was a, and they had been going to this every year. I didn't know anything about it because I was just in the Shenandoah Valley for 9 months, but they had been every year. And the son, who was maybe just starting to be a teenager then, kept watching me the whole time as we were walking along to the shepherds, looking at me. And when he finally got there, he was just outright staring at me. And I thought, what is up with him? Why is he staring at me? But of course, when the angels made their startling noise to the shepherds, I jumped about 4 feet up in the air, startled by it, my heart pounding, my breath suddenly gone from my body. And I remember his mother smiling because she was more subtle, his sister kind of giggling, and he was just outright laughing. And it was funny. But what I carry away from that is, at least the way they portrayed it, the angel's coming was quite startling and, to say the least, surprising, unanticipated. I know the story, but certainly unanticipated. I wonder what it would be like to be a very young woman and to have an angel come to you. Now, this was in the town of Nazareth, so it was a small town. It wasn't in the main religious part of the land, which would have been Jerusalem, where the temple was. It wasn't in the main political part of the land. It was off in this little town, pretty distant away. And it might be that people in that town kind of would have a sense that big things don't happen there. Have you ever lived in a town where you had a sense big things don't happen there? I remember when I grew up in the town of Denton, Texas, one time somebody asked me, what do you do for fun in Denton, Texas? And I said, you drive into Dallas or you drive into Fort Worth, because there just wasn't that much going on, at least from my opinion, in our little town, now quite a big city, half an hour to an hour north of the big city. So Mary, in this little town, a young woman already engaged, has an angel come and visit with her. What would that be like? And then the angel tells her not to be afraid, which angels almost always tell you not to be afraid. That would actually argue against what happened at that nativity scene in the Shenandoah Valley, where the angels were very frightening and scary. Angels, though they are frightening and scary, what they say is, don't be afraid. The angel assures her and then tells her that God needs her to help, and that she is going to have a baby, and that baby will be Christ the Lord. And Mary, being pretty smart and aware of herself and aware of the world, says, how on earth can this be? The words that Sue read, and they are the words that are in the translation that says, how can this be, for I am a virgin. There is a little note, if you have your NRSV with you, in the bottom, and it says, how can this be, for I do not know a man. Another way of saying that as of yet, she was still a single girl, engaged but not married yet, no reason to imagine she would even have a baby. But the angel says that the Holy Spirit will come upon her, and the child she will conceive will be God's Son, Emmanuel. God is with us. And perhaps the most remarkable thing in this story as if a virgin becoming pregnant isn't remarkable. That is remarkable. I'll grant you, that's pretty remarkable. But what is remarkable to me is Mary, this young girl, not married yet, not been with her husband yet, all that future ahead of her, and all that wonder of what it must have been like for her as a young woman, knowing who her husband was going to be and their life was going to be together, and they would have family and they would have love and laughter and life and struggle and all those things. Mary agrees, ahead of all that, to be the mother of God's child and to bring into the world through her own body, her own self, her own being, to bring into the world a little baby who will be Christ the Lord. And Mary offers herself to be God's servant and to do what God needed her to do. We talk in the church sometimes about having a calling or about having a vocation. Protestants aren't as good as using the term vocation as our Roman Catholic brothers and sisters are, but we do, in fact, believe that we can have our vocation. What we do for work is intended to be in service to God. A calling, we use that term, especially like for me. There was a time this congregation voted to call me. I stood in this very pulpit and I preached a sermon, and when the service was over, I went out down the hall and left into the ladies' parlor, and I waited there while Deb Maui Sprague stood at that lectern and called a congregational meeting. Although I talk about it like I was in the room, I wasn't. I think the search committee sat down here ready to answer any questions. And when it was over, the congregation voted. And for the first time in my career, I had been in ministry for 30 years at that point. The first time in my career, the congregation voted unanimously to call me. That is, to invite me to come and live and serve among you as your pastor and teacher, to be a part of your faith and ministry in this place, joining all the history and generations that have gone before as we live in the present and into God's future, whatever it might mean. You voted to call me. And that calling, that invitation to vocation in this place, yes, it had the assurance of your strength as a healthy congregation behind it. That was part of it. You knew how to be a congregation living, serving with a pastor. It also had knowledge of my experience and my skill and the things I've done as a pastor and the things I can do as a pastor. But even more than both of those things, it had a trust that God would lead us into the future together. And that as we seek to be faithful in this place, God's good news will be proclaimed, God's heavenly love will be shared, God's compassion will be made real, and we will seek to serve God's heavenly realm and make God's will come into being in us, through us, around us, even despite us. Mary, this young woman, really an older girl, when you think about it, there are times I think about my teenage years and realize how very young I was. Mary agreed to do what God was asking her to do. I do believe that she had a choice in that, and that she chose, yes, to do what God needed her to do. And because of that, she did, by the power of the Spirit, become pregnant and have a child and raise that child to help him with her husband Joseph's presence to become the one he was intended to be in the world and in God's history, of bringing hope and peace and joy and love into the world. Mary said yes and agreed to do what God was calling her to do. Okay, so not very often do angels come and ask us so clearly what it is God needs for us to do, though there is in the Christian tradition the notion of entertaining angels unaware, that somehow God still sends to us others who are angels to help lead us, guide us, heal us, challenge us, empower us to do what we need to do. There have been interactions I've had with people that I recognized God's hand at work in them as they helped inspire me for the next step of my life's journey. Perhaps you can say the same thing. Just as Mary agreed to do what God needed her to do, and because of her courage and because of her faith, God was able to use her to bring into the world the little baby Jesus who would be and become Christ our Lord. God asks each of us to offer ourselves in service to God's heavenly realm as we seek to do and be a part of God's goodness on earth, making hope known, making joy known, making peace known, making love known, as we offer ourselves on God's behalf. We worship together week after week. In better days in this very room, and those days are coming again. We will worship together again in this room. It seems like it's a long way away, but it really won't be in the fullness of time. We will be back in this room. But now as we worship in our homes or wherever it is that you watch this broadcast of worship each week, we come and we listen and we ponder and we pray. And we receive the gift and the blessing of good news, of words of faith, of prayers of hope, of uplifting music as we seek to be inspired for faithful living. But then the time comes when we turn off the computer or the television, or when we're here, get up and walk out of the building, whether it's to fellowship in parish hall or going off to our cars or to our homes. There comes the time that we are called to do our faith, to live our faith, and to make real in the world around us the things that we have learned in this hour of worship, the inspiration of God's love and care, the promise of God's compassion, the reality that God's strength helps us to do remarkable things. My hope for us this Advent season, as we prepare again for the coming of God in Christ Jesus our Lord, as we welcome him, as we make room for him, as we seek faithfully to receive him, that we would be far more than passive recipients, that we would learn to be like Mary, people who actively work to make God's love known in the world, offering our very selves for the cause in whatever way God might use us, trusting God to give us strength, trusting God to show us the way, trusting God to empower us, that through our lives and our living, love can be made known. Please pray with me. Gracious God, God of heaven and of earth, God of Jesus the Christ, whose birth we anticipate, God of Mary, who in faith agreed to serve you with her whole self, help us, we pray, to find our ways of embodying your love and compassion, that we might live in our lives and in this world as your faithful, loving people. These things we pray in Christ's holy name. Amen. Thank you. come, O long expected Jesus, born to set all people free, from our fears and sins release us, grant us your true liberty. Israel's strength and consolation, hope to all the earth impart, dear desire of every nation, enter every longing heart. Born all people to deliver, born a child you came to reign, born to by your own eternal Spirit, come to claim us as your own. By your all-sufficient merit, let us share your cross and crown. Hear now the benediction. Go in peace to serve God and your neighbor in all that you do, trusting that God fills you with everything you need to embody heavenly love and faithfully to live for yourself and for others. Amen.